Well, welcome to 700 Club Interactive. More than 40 years ago, Martin Luther King had a dream. He wanted to see a society where people would be judged not by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character.
Well, in the years since then, race tensions relations have improved in America. But while the country may have elected its first African-American president, the racial issue in America is really far from over.
The American people made it clear it was time to put race aside and elect the first African-American president.
Because of what we did on this day, in this election, at this defining moment, change has come to America.
But did that historic day change race relations in the country? A poll taken just before the election showed 70% of Americans believed race issues would improve with Obama's election. But after a year in office, those high hopes didn't materialize. Polls show only 41% of Americans believe race relations have improved under Obama, and 22% say they've actually gotten worse. In 2009, the president put himself in the middle of heated national debate over race. He made an off-the-cuff comment about a black Harvard professor arrested by a white police officer.
The Cambridge police acted stupidly.
The comment set off a media frenzy, the president regretting ever getting involved.
I could have calibrated those words differently. My hope is that as a consequence of this event, this ends up being what's called a teachable moment.
In hopes of teaching the nation, he invited the men to the White House for a drink and a chat. The media dubbed it the Beer Summit. Mainstream media and politicians love to play the race card. It gets people's attention and always stirs emotion. Earlier this year, Mississippi Governor Haley Barbour drew fire from his opponents for refusing to condemn license plates honoring a Confederate general and KKK leader. Then there's Marilyn Davenport, a Republican activist in California who's making headlines for sending an email to colleagues with Obama's face on the body of a chimpanzee. She claims the email wasn't meant to be racist. Obama's historic election did not end racism in the United States, but it did transform the issue and change the conversation. Charlene Israel, CBN News.
I don't think it did end racism in America, because racism is it's literally a consciousness, and it's sometimes very subtle. There's a Harvard study, and if you want to go on to take this test, where they put it up online, where they ask questions, and at the end you get a rating on how racist you are. And on the subtle side of it, when you start to identify character traits to a particular people group, well, then you've slipped into racism. There's something else called a reverse racism, where you can be targeted as well if you're in the majority and assumptions made about how you think and what is the content of your character, again, solely based on what is the color of your skin. There was a famous study done by a middle school teacher, a grammar school teacher in Iowa. It happened right after the assassination of Martin Luther King. And what she did, it's called the Elliott Study, and what she did is she said, well, we're going to arbitrarily say everybody in the class who has blue eyes is smarter and everybody in the class who has brown eyes is dumber. And you got to sit in special places in the classroom. But the amazing thing is the children took on that identity. And previously performing students who had brown eyes could no longer perform at the same level that they used to. That's called the subtle racism of low expectations. The particular groups in schools, in jobs, in the society in general, actually take on an identity that lowers them and actually causes them to underperform. Now, as a Christian, what does all this mean? We're expected to obviously perform at a very high level, because we're expected to be just like Jesus Christ. Now, do we all hit it? No. And the main reason is we haven't really changed our thinking as Christians to understand the good news of what Jesus did. So often we think of Jesus showing us God and how loving God is, but he also came to show us what we can be if we just let God work in our lives, if we just let God transform our thinking. Here it is from the Apostle Paul. It's from Galatians chapter 3, verses 26 through 29. For you are all of us, are sons of God. You can change that translation. We are all children of God. Through faith, that's how we get it, through faith in Jesus Christ. When we have faith in him, then we literally get his DNA. We get reborn, we get remade. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. So we get the anointing. That's what this Greek word means, Christ. It means the anointing. We get the Holy Spirit. If we were baptized into the anointing, then we get the anointing. We get the literal presence of God with us at all times. It's transformational. And we become one with him. That was the prayer of Jesus, that we would be one. We become one together. We become one with him, God in us and us in God. And when that happens, there's neither Jew nor Greek. There's neither slave nor free. There's neither male nor female. For you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you are Christ, then you're Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. And that means that you get all the promises of God, all of them. You get every single one. They're all yes and amen. No longer is there Jew and Greek, slave, free, male, female, but we're all one. And when we get that idea, we get free of any racial consciousness. Terry, over to you.
Well, up next, your questions on race from our inbox. Mike wants to know, is racial profiling morally wrong? We'll weigh in on that and more, so don't go away.
The doctor said to me, Peggy, you don't understand. Pancreatic cancer is inoperable and incurable. And he says, well, Peggy, you've got 2 months to live. It was like he was telling me, go to the store. There was no compassion. Yeah, it was heartbreaking. My life was an hourglass. I was home, laying on the couch, just dying. My sister Pam called the Cancer Treatment Centers of America. When I got there, I knew that I was going to be cared for. I met with the doctor after the tests were done and said, how long do I have? And he looked at me and he said, Peggy, we did a lot of tests on you. And I never saw one thing stamped on the bottom of your foot that said you were going to die in 2 months. You have no expiration date. I thought, wow.
Cancer Treatment Centers of America is unlike any other cancer hospital, full of hope, committed to your fight. We use every weapon, surgery, chemotherapy, radiation, nutrition, spiritual support, and mind-body medicine. We surround you with a real team, working together, all under one roof.
Each time I went back to the Cancer Treatment Centers of America, I responded better. My tumors were shrinking. Came back in September again, and they still couldn't see anything. I said, you're kidding me. We'll see how it goes. We'll keep testing, but we can't see the tumors anymore.
Please call the number on your screen to speak with an oncology information specialist and receive a life-changing information kit and DVD packed with valuable information. Call now and learn about treatment options you may not even know exist.
It's really unbelievable how one doctor can tell me I have 2 months to live. And then I go to the Cancer Treatment Centers of America and they save my life. Hope is a mainstay. Hope is everything.
Don't give up. Your fight is our fight. Call Cancer Treatment Centers of America today.
Well, recently we had a poll on Facebook asking you if you had ever been the victim of racism or if you had known someone who has. Nearly 70% of you said yes. Are you surprised at that number?
Actually, I am. Maybe I shouldn't be, but I am. For me, growing up in the South in the 1960s, racism was just part of the culture. And so I guess the answer here is, yeah, it was part of our culture.
Yeah. Where do you think it's at today? Do you think it's changed a lot?
I think it's changed a huge amount. And it's gotten a lot better to see the advancement in our culture. Gives me a great hope.
Well, you know, you can legislate some of these things, but you can't change people's hearts. That's a process, and it takes time. I mean, it's not a simple thing to try to transition.
Well, the difference was between a segregated society where you have a whites only counter and whites only in the front of the bus and white only drinking fountain, those kinds of things. When you get rid of that and literally you force people to live together, okay, there's nothing like it. There's nothing like the experience of living together to get rid of those racial stereotypes where you start saying, hey, what I used to think was wrong.
Well, every once in a while, you know, when I see some kind of a historical overview of things and I look at it, I realize the things you mentioned were not that long ago. I mean, they really weren't. In our lifetime, those things happened. And it's if you were a person to whom that happened, I think it was incredibly degrading. I don't know how you easily move past that, you know.
With God's grace, you can.
Yes.
And I have seen God's grace in evidence. For me, and I guess a lot of, if you're a white American, your experience as the target of racism is probably non-existent.
Yeah.
For me, I found that out for the first time when I traveled in China. And things got really tense on a train. I didn't know why. And then one of the Chinese I was with started telling me they're calling you foreign devil, and they're calling you pig fat, and they don't like you in the dining car. Mm-hmm. That was
the first time you'd experienced something like that.
That was an eye-opening experience, to have that kind of reaction to just me walking in,
just being there.
That was an interesting thing. Another time, I was excluded from an event in India. I was with a group of Filipinos. They all got invited in, and I was just there.
How'd you feel?
I didn't like that at all.
I bet not.
And when you go through these experiences, then on the other
side,
you get a little awareness because you're walking in their shoes and you get to understand it.
Well, we've got an inbox question from Mike here who asks, is racial profiling morally or biblically unacceptable? I feel I was a victim several years ago. I was pulled over for no reason and had to sit in the squad car while the police searched my car for drugs and guns. Nothing was found, of course, but the entire event felt humiliating.
Mike, what's going on in American culture, particularly targeting African-American young men with crimes? It's sort of like, let's go out and round up the usual suspects. And so if there's a crime in a neighborhood, then any black male who is in the vicinity then gets interviewed and targeted by the police. And you look at the number of recent releases where DNA evidence has come into play. You look at the number of African Americans who've been released from jail because they were falsely convicted. Because of just the practices of the police. So you look at that and you go, absolutely, that's immoral. And that should not be happening in a free and open society. At the same time, I'm aware of what Mossad does and the security forces in Israel. And they very definitely engage in profiling, not racial profiling, but they engage in a profiling to try to find terrorists. Mm-hmm. And they've been very effective in doing that. You used to hear a lot about airplanes being hijacked from El Al. You don't hear that anymore. And it all is a series of questions trying to elicit responses, part of it random and part of it based on a profile that's not racial, but they're looking for certain behavior patterns.
But I will say that I've been to Israel a number of times, and I feel very uncomfortable when I'm going through that process at the airport. I'm always very grateful to get on a safe airplane, but it is a little awkward, you know. Okay, this is...
You're under the microscope.
Yes.
What you can't say can and will be used against you.
This is from Amy. She says, I am a mother of three. One of my daughters is interested in dating an African-American boy. I've raised my children not to be racist, and I love the fact that she's colorblind. But at the same time, I feel they should not be unequally yoked in this area.
Amy, unequally yoked does not apply here. Unequally yoked is specific. A believer should not be unequally yoked with an unbeliever. It's not a racial thing. It's unequally yoked with an unbeliever. I used to joke that the one way to solve all racial problems in America is have everybody marry everybody else, and we'd all become one. There is still racism, and you have to look at this and understand that for the children of the marriage, there may be some issues. Hopefully, as we mature as a culture and things get more open, they won't have to go through those issues, but there will be issues now. So I think some counseling, but it's certainly there's nothing unbiblical about it.
I think, Amy, maybe it's a wonderful opportunity for you to examine why do I feel anxious about this? You know, it may be what you're saying, just a concern that your children would go through the difficulty of mm-hmm. having to face this. But on the other hand, the thing that you say, that hopefully one day all of this will change, starts when we don't have these feelings anymore. Right. You know, as the mother of a biracial son, I have an opinion on that. Okay.
What's wrong with my boy?
Yeah, that's right. In fact, quick, fast story. Tyler was an athlete in high school, and he said one day after one of the games, the African-American guys were all standing around in the locker room, and one of them said to the rest of them, well, has your mom given you the black girl talk yet? And Tyler said, the black girl talk? And he said, yeah, you know, we're black guys, we should date black girls. And Tyler said, well, my mom's white. I don't think I'm getting that talk. But, you know, we need to get to the place where we enjoy each other's differences and appreciate each other's history and culture and background and persons, you know, so we can move to the place you're talking about. Mm-hmm. This is Steve, who writes, I heard someone on the radio who was from a civil rights group. He called for African Americans to boycott white businesses. Someone else said that was reverse racism, but the man said he was just trying to encourage African Americans to shop in stores primarily run by other African Americans, which would keep money within the black community. I thought both made good points. What do you think?
I think that they don't understand modern commerce. You know, how are you going to, when you buy a product, how are you ever going to know who put that together? In today's world, you're buying from China, you're buying from Indonesia, you're buying from Latin America, you're buying from all over the world. And all of that gets funneled into stores. And do you really know the shareholders of the companies that are running those stores? And I would imagine it's a wide mix of races if it's a publicly traded company. And then, you know, who are the employees? You know, you just can't say, well, I'm only going to go to the neighborhood store. In today's world, that just doesn't work. If you want to favor certain local establishments, by all means, do it. But you're going to have a tough time on every purchase to say, you know, I've got some kind of racial test, because there's no way you can know. I mean, this is... We live in a global economy now, and you just can't identify the source of goods.
Yeah. And I can understand that this could happen just naturally, because it's all about relationship with people. And, you know, you tend to frequent businesses owned by people you know or run by people you know. So, but to
yeah,
I
but
think
we've gone
the
a
issue
long way from the neighborhood store where for the village and, you know, the shop owner is looking at, I want you as my customer for the next 20 years, and therefore I'm going to treat you, you know, we've really gone far from that, and mm-hmm. particularly in an internet commerce culture,
yes.
There's just no way you can have that.
Yeah. By its nature, it won't work. Well, you can always be part of the conversation by liking us on Facebook or by going to our website. That's 700clubinteractive.com. While you're there, watch our story on Johnny Lee Clary, a former Imperial Wizard in the Ku Klux Klan. I think you'll be impressed by that interview, at least impacted by it. Well, up next, two children who weren't even welcome on the streets of their own city.
Saw you on TV. Gotta say, it was painful to watch.
Try living it.
Spend 7 days in utopia.
Wow.
You'll find your game.
First, you have to see it. Feel it. Trust it.
Reminds me of someone else I used to know.
That he does.
I think some time here might do you good.
Sure is beautiful.
I don't think that you're coming here was an accident.
7 days in utopia. Rated G.
Saw you on TV. Gotta say, it was painful to watch.
Try living it.
Spend 7 days in utopia.
Wow.
You'll find your game.
First, you have to see it. Feel it. Trust it.
Reminds me of someone else I used to know.
That he does.
I think some time here might do you good.
Sure is beautiful.
I don't think that your coming here was an accident.
7 days in utopia. Rated G.
A few years ago, the two children in this next story lost everything, their parents, their home, and their friends. They were outcasts until they found a home with CBN's Orphans Promise.
Shintu and his sister Rekha lived on the outskirts of Delhi, India. Even though they were healthy, most people didn't go anywhere near them because their parents are lepers.
People outside would say, "Don't go to their house, or you'll become like them." Our father would work in the fields and drive a rickshaw. But after he lost some of his fingers and toes, it was hard for him to walk.
I used to think, my father puts himself through so much pain in order to take care of us.
When there was barely enough food to eat, their parents had no other choice but to take them to a children's home, sponsored by Orphans Promise. It was the last time the children would ever see them. But it was the first time Shintu and Rekha felt accepted by others.
When we came here, we were given everything. We got beds and a nice house with electricity.
I liked having something to eat. I liked pizza and fish.
And they were finally able to get a good education.
I like riding in the school bus. Now, nobody teases us.
And they soon learned about Jesus Christ.
They told me Jesus is the one true God who died and rose on the third day. I started believing in God and he showed me how to be a good boy.
One day, as I was walking towards the church altar, I heard Jesus say to me, "My child, don't cry." That's when I started to believe in Jesus.
Now Shintu and Rekha want to use what they've learned to help others.
When I grow up, I want to become a preacher and teach others to share, because when someone doesn't have anything, people need to help.
I love Jesus very much. I'm not hungry anymore. I get everything I need. And everybody shows me love.
I want to thank Orphans Promise. They took good care of us and helped us when we didn't have anything.
I visited this children's home. It is a wonderful place. The children are amazing. You know, I love that part of the world, but the caste system is a really awful thing. To be nothing, to matter to no one, to have no voice, to know that you're alone in the world and you have no place to turn to. And then you make it possible, if you're a 700 Club member, for us to come into the midst of that emptiness and hopelessness and sadness, just a deep sadness that's in the hearts of these children, and say, God loves you, that you are precious in his sight. He has a plan and a purpose for your life. To give them food every day. Did you hear them say it's wonderful to be in this house where there's electricity? Most of these people do not live in situations like this. Many of these children never have an opportunity to go to school. So when you partner with Orphans Promise, you make it possible for us to say there is a God who loves you and you are valued. There's hope for your future. There's promise in who you are. We want to invite you to be a part of that, because our ability to move into situations like this is dependent on your willingness to be a part of what we're doing. So if you'd like to be a part of that, just go to your phone and call our toll-free number right now. It's 1-888-777-1999. You can also give by logging onto cbn.com.
All right, it's time for some chat questions. Let's go over to Marguerite for the first one.
Esther says, is genderism just as bad, especially in the church?
I assume by genderism, you're the divide between male and female. And, you know, if you can understand this first, God made them male and female in his image, then we've got to understand that both male and female is in the image of God. And I think we've gotten away from that. Certainly, when you read the passage from Galatians, we're neither male nor female. We're all one in Christ. That talks about a unique unity that the world had not seen until the baptism of the Holy Spirit, when the women were having a prayer meeting and the disciples were with them, because the Bible is very specific. The disciples were with the women in the upper room. I've heard some preachers say, well, that means there were 11 of them and 109 women. You know, you go to any prayer meeting in the world today, you'll find it about 80% women. So, you know, those are the ones that pray. And that's the group that God poured out the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost. So he obviously approves. And when you read Joel, I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh. And then he's very specific. You know, my handmaids are going to prophesy. Your sons and your daughters are going to prophesy. That he's very intentional that he's going to use them and use them mightily and use them in miracles. Now, in the early church, you had the example of Priscilla and Aquila, and they went out and ministered together. You have the example of Phoebe, who was the scribe for Paul, who wrote the book of Romans, and then was tasked by Paul to carry the book of Romans to that letter to the church in Rome. And then he commanded in the letter that the Roman church provide for her financially. And he used a very unusual word, diakonos, that is everywhere else is translated as a deacon. You know, that she's a deacon and you need to treat her with dignity. The English translation, you know, turned that into a servant, and it's the only time that word is translated that way. But when you understand she's the scribe that wrote it and then was the ambassador from Paul to deliver it, well, that's a pretty high place. I think we need to recognize that women absolutely have a role in ministry. Now, you look at the passages, women aren't supposed to speak. Well, that's a cultural thing, that women were interrupting the service by asking questions of their husbands. And so there's this great murmuring going on. And Paul said, well, we've got to be quiet when I'm teaching. So that's it. And there's another one, women shouldn't have authority over a man. And I'm in accordance with that. I don't think men should be discipled by women. There's a mentoring process and a mirroring process that goes along, and men really need to be encouraged by other men. So with those two caveats, let's open up the gates a little bit. What do you think?
I agree with you on all of those things. The thing I don't agree on is, you know, a number of years ago, I don't know if you remember this, Anne Graham Lotz, who's a wonderful Bible teacher, was invited to a particular denomination's meeting of a lot of the male leadership in that group. Invited by them, and when she stood up to speak, they all got up and turned their chairs and their backs to her and sat down. I think that we need to learn, even when we disagree with each other on some things.
That's just rude.
It's rude. Yeah. We need to live with respect and regard for each other in unity. And so, you know, this can be a very divisive issue, but it doesn't have to be. We can live above and beyond that, you know, and still honor the Lord by how we live and how we love each other.
All right. That's all the time we have for this program. We leave you this wonderful word from Galatians 3. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus.